Hello, everybody, and welcome to this first webinar of the Picasso project. I hope everybody can hear me well. I'm Margot Betti from APRE, one of the partners of the project. This will be a webinar on the existing funding initiatives on 5G between the EU and US. So we will explore which are the collaboration in place and which are the funding opportunities that the European Funding Programme for Research and Innovation Horizon 2020 provides. In particular, so we will explore we will explore the US innovation ecosystem, the established collaboration between, in particular, between the two major initiatives, the 5G Public-Private Partnership and 5G Americas, and more in particular, which are the technical objectives that have been set in this 5G Public-Private Partnership. Afterwards, we will see what the Horizon 2020 program has set as opportunities or funding opportunities in this matter. So, this is the agenda of the day. First, we will have a short introduction to the Picasso project made by Dr. Eva Fadil, which is the project coordinator. Then we will have a focus on Picasso's activities concerning 5G with a representative, the partner representative of the 5G expert group of Picasso. Then Dr. Werner Mohr from the 5G Infrastructure Association will explain us a bit better what is the 5G public-private partnership structure in Europe, its strategic research agenda, and what is set as the collaboration with 5G Americas. We will close with a focus on the calls, so the real funding opportunities. Then we will open the floor for your questions.
Okay, hello everybody, I'm Marta Calderaro from APRE, and I will show you just few information on how to enable your microphone in the case, just in the case, but of course your audio speakers, as well as write questions. So you will be able to write on the top of the page. You will be able here where there is the pointer to enable your audio speakers. As well, you will be able to write your question by the chat. To open a question between the everyone questions for all, also for our office, so Ufficio APRE. You will also able to raise your hand if it's needed to pay the attention to your questions. Okay, so I will leave the floor to Mrs. Eva Fadil, the coordinator of Picasso project. Thank you.
Yeah, good morning to the US-based participants. Good afternoon to the EU-based participants. And welcome to our webinar. I'm glad that we have such a good respondent rate. My name is Eva Fadil. I'm working at InnoTSD. Which is the Picasso coordinator based in France. We are a consultancy EU-wide active, and we are very glad to now present you our first webinar, which is on the 5G. And I would like first of all to introduce very shortly the Picasso project to you, to show you what our basis is in the project and what is also in the project for you in terms of benefits and opportunities for any further interaction or engagement with us. Now, what is Picasso? So Picasso, besides being a celebrated painter, is a European Commission-funded collaborative project, which means that we are working together with a number of partners from the EU and from the US to make this happen. The project has started in January 2016, so only some months ago, and it will last until June 2018. During this period, our mission is to enhance EU and US ICT research and innovation collaboration. This is very specifically targeted to several focus areas. We are trying to respond to the societal challenges that can be seen both in the EU and in the US, and of course also the industry needs in the field. So our focus areas are 5G, big data, Internet of Things and cyber-physical systems, and a transversal group on policy dialogue. The focus areas are in fact supported through the setup of four dedicated expert groups on these four areas. And we are glad that we have a high number of very renowned members from the EU and US in those fields in our project. So this is actually the unique feature of our project, the synergy between the ICT policies and ICT technologies. We have 5G, big data, Internet of Things, cyber-physical systems, and on the other hand, the policy dialogue. The target group of our project for this webinar, for all our other activity, are stakeholders from research, development, innovation, of course, from industry and also policymakers. Now, what do we propose to you besides this webinar? What we do in Picasso is a certain number of analysis and reports on the first plan. So the analysis are about the ICT landscape, which means the industrial drivers, societal needs, policy gaps, existing networks, initiatives, projects, in the EU and in the US, and of course the collaboration opportunities between EU and US in this field. Now, based on this analysis, we will provide an opportunity report which will contain concrete recommendations for possible future collaboration. Of course, very specifically targeted to our expert topics. And these future topics will be proposed to EU and US funding agencies, and hopefully there will be some concrete opportunities for collaboration for you and other partners afterwards. Besides this, we will have a certain number of policy briefs and also recommendations white paper for policymakers, where we will specify the needs and priorities to set up strategic activities together. And here I would like to already announce you that we will have a first policy brief available very soon, which is on the topic of privacy and data protection. Now, besides these interesting analyses and reports, we will also have a certain number of tools and services available for you. The first one would be the ICT toolkit, as we call it, which is a dedicated section of our website and especially a mobile application, which is aimed at providing you very concrete and smart access to information on ICT activities in the EU and the US. So specifically the programs where you could find collaboration opportunities, existing networks, initiatives, projects, different opportunities to find collaboration partners, etc. Part of this toolkit and also separately will be the help desk service that we are launching, which is the possibility for you to interact with our project experts and ask questions and support for finding suitable collaboration partners for EU-US ICT collaboration, how to engage, how to set up a collaboration team, etc. This will be launched very soon, And we will, of course, always give a notification on our website and through social media when this is available for you. Then we will have a certain number of webinars. This first one is opening to several more, which will be on funding opportunities or collaboration opportunities, both in Horizon 2020, but also in US programs. And we will have five webinars on policy gaps. So the first one, which will be related to the policy brief that is supposed to be available very soon. This first policy webinar on privacy and data protection will take place in October. And here again, we will announce the concrete date and registration details on our website very soon. Inside the webinars, we have other means of interaction for you, concretely to meet us physically. For example, at our high-level event, which is a transatlantic symposium on technology and policy for a smart society in Minneapolis, the USA, which will take place on 19th and 20th of June 2017. So the date has already been fixed and we have just launched a call for sessions. You can find details on this on our website. But please already note the dates in your calendars. You will be very welcome to join us. And besides this large-scale event, we will also have several meetings of our expert groups on our four thematic areas, which will most probably be related to public events and where you will also be welcome to join. We will also announce these in due time in our project website and social media. Now, I hope I could show you very quickly the different opportunities that we have for you to engage in Picasso, the different benefits this project can bring to you. And I hope we will find you back soon in other project activity, events, etc. Now, let me just specify how you can, in the meantime, be in touch. So our project coordinator is Svetlana Klasova from InnoTSD, who will be happy to get notification from you if you would like to address her. I will be happy to answer any questions you might have. I'm the dissemination contact. And as I said, we have a help desk, which you can reach through the contact at picasso-project.eu email address, where you can ask your specific questions on collaboration opportunities. We also have, of course, our website, which is regularly updated and where you can find relevant information, our social media. And if it's not already done already, I would like to invite you to register to our emailing list, which you can see on the link that is indicated on the slide. We will send regular project updates, not too often, so not to spam you, but to provide you valuable information on different opportunities that can open up where you will possibly like to participate or to be informed about. Now, I would like to give the floor to our next presenter from the University of Dresden, who will give you short information on the activity of the 5G expert group in Picasso, and then, of course, in the following, the information on the 5G collaboration opportunities and calls in Horizon 2020. Thank you again, and I'd like now to invite Mr. Moore to present us a little bit on the existing infrastructure and networks, both in EU and US, and how collaboration is established. And then in the following, of course, speak about the calls that are open on the topic. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much for your introduction. Good morning to the colleagues in the US and good afternoon to the colleagues in Europe. I would first like to give an overview. What does a public-private partnership mean in this context of European collaborative research? Because this is a somehow complex machinery. Can I move the slides myself? No, I think not. Then can you please go to the next one?
You can move them with the small arrows on the left, bottom left of your screen, but I'll move to the next one.
Ah, yeah, now I see. Now I see again. Okay. This is the outline of my presentation. Maybe we can directly go to the next slides. What is currently happening happens in a global context. There are more and more countries and regions active in 5G research and development. When you look here, there are several countries in Europe. That means there are national activities. We have the activities in the European Union of the European Commission research program. And then in many other countries you see, like in the US, there are activities. Brazil is now starting a lot in China, in several other Asian countries. Then NGMN, the Forum of Network Operators, is very active. And then you see also logos here. There is this 5G PPP logo, and we have signed memoranda of understanding with counterparts in other regions, like with 5G Americas, which is not only the US, they are basically representing the entire continent. Then with a counterpart in China, in Japan, and in Korea. And in addition, at the very bottom of the slide, we have signed a multilateral MOU to organize a series of global events where people from the different regions meet, where we discuss, where we exchange views. And this should all help to come to common views on 5G. But that does mean from a European perspective, we are looking at different regions, and the focus is basically on these regions, which have a major impact also on future standardization. And this is then also shown on the next slide, why we are believing that collaborative research is important in this context. You could basically say we have three major elements in the development of future systems. We have a pre-competitive research phase, we have a standardization phase, and at the end there is product development, market introduction. And that basically means there is quite some common interest in the research phase. That means in that phase there is a good chance for cooperation and also for consensus building. When we go towards standards, the common interest is going down, competition is increasing, and when we move further on, then of course competition is dominating when we are in the phase of product development and market introduction. And that means the important part is this early research phase. We are still to a certain extent in that phase, and there we have a good chance to build consensus via collaborative research projects. The PPP has, of course, a history. This is going back to 2012-2013, where the EU commissioner approached industry at Mobile World Congress in Barcelona whether we wouldn't work together in a public-private partnership on 5G to bring all the major stakeholders together. The next slide was already shown by Steffen. This is coming from ITU-R vision recommendation. And what is important here, that 5G has basically three major pillars. There is enhanced mobile broadband, which you could say is somehow a further evolution of that what we have today with fourth generation systems or LTE. Then we have massive machine type communication and ultra reliable and low latency communication. These two are mainly to support vertical industries, and there are many different domains, like in smart cities, support of utilities, Or when we go for ultra-reliable low latency communication, this is for example for self-driving cars, autonomous driving, all the mission-critical applications, mission-critical utilities like energy, water, gas, and so on. That means the basic idea in 5G is to support more and more application sectors, which we have not done that way in today's mobile and wireless communication systems. And that also means we are getting new requirements, new technical requirements in terms of throughput rate, which should be much higher than today, in terms of the user data rate, which means which the user really sees. The user doesn't usually see the peak rate. The user sees a fraction of that. Spectrum efficiency is very important. The mobility, that means which mobile speeds can be supported. There are challenging requirements to get much lower latency than that what we can provide today. Then the density of devices, which is mainly coming from IoT, machine type communication, then the energy efficiency and area capacity. And ITU has done a rather generic mapping of these, I would say still rather generic technical requirements to certain application domains. And according to ITU, this more green part are the requirements for enhanced mobile broadband. The blue requirements are the focus requirements for massive machine type communication. And this yellow part are more the focus requirements for ultra reliable and low latency communications. This is agreed on global basis, but all these different fora, which I've shown before, have developed own white papers, they have their own requirement sets, which are fortunately similar to this, but they are not the same. That means there is still work needed to discuss on international level, to harmonize the requirements, when we really want to go for globally accepted standards. What is PPP? I don't want to go through all the text. The PPP is based on a European law, which is a regulation on Horizon 2020. And there it said that there are these so-called contractual arrangements between the private side and the European Commission. And there is a contractual arrangement on a specific topic, which in our case is 5G. Then there are, of course, requirements. This should be done in an open and transparent way. That means the PPP is not a closed shop. Participation in projects has to be open. We defined then very high level requirements. There is, of course, a much more detailed research agenda. But this is going back to about 2013, these high-level requirements, which means much higher area capacity should be supported, significant savings in energy consumption in future networks, because we can imagine if the traffic is growing, we cannot grow energy consumption in parallel. We have to do quite a lot against that. Then also from operator perspective, the service creation time should be significantly reduced. And that means we have to go for software-defined networks, software-defined systems. We have to get all the flexibility that we can do that. Then reliability is very important. That means downtime should be more or less zero when we really want to support mission critical applications. Then the scalability with the huge number of devices, sensors, machine type communication is an important issue. And then also user controlled privacy of data and how data are handled. This of course results in much more detailed requirements and also different research elements, which we have to support. And then we have defined the research program. This is again rather generic here. There are much more details in the research agenda. That means we are looking at the different networking means, which are the wireless networks, optical networks, the network management. These systems are becoming more complex, therefore network management is very important. And then convergence beyond access at the last mile. That basically means also to integrate today's systems with future access systems on a common platform. Because then we can also reuse existing investment, available coverage from today's systems, but can add new capabilities which today's systems cannot provide. And then part is also to redesign the overall network, and that means we will see more and more IT elements which are be used in communication networks. Therefore, these issues like information-centric networks, NFV, SDN, and clouds are more and more important in already today, in today's networks, and in particular in future networks. And then, of course, availability, robustness, security are important issues. And we are also looking from the very beginning at hardware implementation, because 5G will address new frequency bands in much higher bands, the millimeter wave range up to about 70, 80 gigahertz. And with the high throughput rates, the very challenging signal processing algorithms, we also have to look at the implementation of the processors at an early stage. How this is organized? This looks, of course, somehow complex, but the structure is coming from the legal framework. There is a contract between the European Commission and the private side. The private side is represented by an association. Then, under the umbrella of this PPP, we have research projects, which are indicated here. Each of these research projects has a contract with the European Commission, where the description of work is agreed and where the budget is agreed. But in the PPP, these projects are cooperating. And they are cooperating in areas of common interest. In order to support that cooperation, we have technology-oriented working groups here. I will show you later which groups are there. And under the umbrella of the association, we have also policy-oriented working groups, which are looking at vision, requirements, pre-standards, support of small and medium-sized enterprises, spectrum, community building, international cooperation, and also to check whether we are meeting the KPIs. That means we have all these collaboration means in place. There are also the necessary legal agreements, consortia agreements that we can exchange information between the different groups. Then for the daily management of this research effort, we have a steering board, which is composed of the project coordinators of these different projects, and the technology board, which is composed of the technical managers of these projects. In addition to this structure, we have also a European technology platform, which is called Networks, which has about 1,000 member organizations. And Also from there, we are getting a lot of input on the research agenda and what are the relevant research topics. We are currently in the process to change the governance. That means we will maintain the cooperation here, but we had a closer link between the platform and the association. And there we are currently implementing changes in the overall governance. But the overall structure, how the PPP is organized, that will remain. Here you see the current members of the association and are highlighted. We have currently two member companies here in bold from the US. When you go through, you also see companies from other regions like from Japan, China, Korea. Part of the change of the governance model is to have an open membership where basically everyone in the sector can apply for membership in the association. And that also means that then of course more companies from the US can easily join this association. Here you see how we organize the projects and the cooperation of projects. We are currently in phase one. And here you see again the parallel projects, and they are cooperating on certain areas of common interest. For example, on architecture issues, interface specifications, on SDN topics and so on. That means the projects are defining what are these areas for cooperation, and then they are setting up the means. We are currently preparing phase two. The call is open. I will show this in the second part of the presentation. And then we are expecting two more calls, one next year and the last call in 2019. But this basically indicates that here are not projects in isolation. These projects are part of an overall program and they are cooperating. Here we have the policy-oriented working groups under the umbrella of the association. And there you see they are addressing pre-standards. How can we contribute research results to international standardization? Then on spectrum, there's the same question, how to contribute to the preparatory process of the next World Radio Communication Conference. Then we have a cooperation with quite a few other groups on vision and societal challenges. Here's basically the discussion with vertical sectors. In this working group, we are looking at how do we contribute to the KPIs in our contract. Then in international cooperation, we have here the relation to our counterparts in different regions. Here I should change to 5G Americas. They have changed name. And these are two working groups which are more dealing with European aspects. But cooperation with US organization could, for example, work via a 5G Americas. I should say the European Commission has signed agreements on government level, for example, with Japan, Korea and China, and in the meantime also with Brazil, Brazilian government. But with the US, there are so far only discussions ongoing. There is no agreement reached on a government agreement on 5G. This is something where on government level we are looking for, let's say, improvements. Then we have the second set of working groups, which are the technology-oriented working groups. There's, for example, one on architecture, then on use cases and performance evaluation. How do we really evaluates the performance of the new systems, the new algorithms, then a working group on SDN and NFV, on network management and security. And these are, let's say, areas of common interest across the different projects. And that means the projects are basically working in a matrix structure where they are working on their own elements, but also on cooperation with neighboring projects. Here would briefly show the different steps for implementation. These PPPs are a new instrument in the European funded project landscape. The first call for proposals was already in 2013. We signed the contractual arrangement with the European Commission basically at the same time. That was only a few days after the call was launched. Then here we see the budget. In the time frame between 2014 and 2020, there's about 700 million euro public funding. And this is matched by a similar amount from, by the private side. Private side means industry, the research community, and small and medium-sized enterprises. And then in addition, there will be a leveraging factor, in particular in industry, by company internal research on 5G. Then we had an official launch of the PPP at the Mobile World Congress 2014 with the press event of the European Commissioner and CTOs of several companies. The first set of proposals were submitted in November 2014, and these projects then started in July last year. We also developed a vision document, which we published again at Mobile World Congress 2015. The document is available at this link. And then when we look on a little bit at this vision document, like in ITU, we see the different traffic classes, like very high throughput systems, then mainly in IoT. These are low energy systems, and then for mission critical applications, low latency systems. But then it's important to look at different vertical sectors. This list is not exhaustive, but it basically indicates basically all sectors in our economy, in our society, are increasingly using ICT systems. And that means we have to understand what are the requirements of these systems and what do we really have to support in the design. Then we also developed, similar like ITU, a spider diagram of major requirements. These are similar, but they are not the same like in ITU. But again, latency is there, but here we are talking about end-to-end latency, not only of the radio system, and then several other of these technical requirements. We have then, especially last year, extended our cooperation with vertical sectors. We have then first focused on these first five sectors, factories, healthcare, energy, media, and automotive. There, the different working groups developed specific white papers. We have then developed, based on that, an overall white paper, which we published this year at the Mobile World Congress in Barcelona again in a press event with the EU Commissioner and representatives from major companies. And an important outcome of that is we have, for example, looked at what are technical requirements of different vertical sectors. And this is, where is the error? Here's the error. And the interesting message of these different diagrams is, even within each basic use case, like factories, you find many different sub-use cases. And there it simply depends on the different processes in factories. And when we then also compare these spider diagrams between different sectors, there are also major differences. And that again is saying 5G has to provide a lot of flexibility that we can adapt the system to the needs of certain application domains. The architecture working group between projects also developed a white paper. There are a lot of discussions ongoing on the overall architecture. And you also see here we have an underlying infrastructure layer, which should be as similar as possible for all the different application domains. But when we go higher up here in the different layers, we see there are, depending on the different use cases like mobile broadband or here factories or automotive, there we will see different instantiations of the overall network. That means the goal is to have as much as possible the same underlying physical infrastructure. But when we go higher up in the layers, we will see then more specific instantiations of the system. But this is work which is ongoing, and where different projects are contributing to this development. Let's have a short look on Call One, where projects are already implemented. Call One had a funding budget of 125 million euro, and it was addressing the radio networks, radio technologies, the convergence, which is more on the architectural side, integration of different access systems, network management, and the core network, mainly based on IT elements. But that means Call One was already addressing major building blocks of future networks. And here we see now the portfolio. Oh no, before we come to the portfolio, I want to explain how do we get to projects. The European Commission is very keen that this happens open and transparent. Therefore, they are publishing a call for proposals. When this is available, then there are consortia which are built, and this consortia builds themselves. They are not built by European Commission or by others. Organizations are coming together and agree to prepare proposals in areas where they have common interests. And that means in this phase, they are preparing proposals. They have to be submitted at a fixed deadline. And after that, the European Commission is organizing an evaluation process by means of independent evaluators. And this part is a competitive process, these elements, because there is an oversubscription and the different consortia are competing for the same budget. Therefore, we have to regard this part as a competitive process. After the selection of projects, they are implemented. That means they sign an agreement with the European Commission. And then they are starting, and we are then in the PPP also implementing all the cooperation means between projects. Yeah, now we come to the project portfolio. There is a set of radio-related projects which are dealing with different elements, different frequency ranges, different aspects, like, for example, here on architecture, or on spectrum management, or on RAN design, below 6 gigahertz, above 6 gigahertz. But that is covering quite well the different elements. Then we have projects dealing with front haul, back haul, which is important for network deployment. Then a project dealing with implementation issues, which is addressing very high frequencies, signal processing algorithms, microelectronics. Then a cluster of projects dealing with network management. Several projects are looking on the core network side, different elements there. Then security. There are two projects. And the last one is a coordination and support action, which is facilitating the overall cooperation between these projects. Basically, this portfolio is supporting quite well the future architecture. Here are some statistics. They are based on available material. Basically, what you can see are the involved countries. And when you go through, there is, of course, a focus on participants from European countries. But we have here the US. There are not too many partners from the US. I think these are two or three. But you also see there's China involved, there is Korea involved, there is Japan involved. Usually these are organizations where the European subsidiaries are participating in these projects. But there is quite a huge number of countries involved. In total, there are around 160 or more than 160 organizations involved. And that is already a quite big diversity of partner organizations. Yeah, when we look at the international cooperation, we signed an MOU with Chinese counterpart in September last year. Also, the European Commission signed an agreement. We also signed an agreement in March last year with our Japanese counterpart. There's also a government agreement from European Commission. Then this was the first agreement with Korea, which was already signed in June 2014. Again, there's an agreement on government level available. Then we signed in March last year with 5G Americas. But as I said before, there's for the time being no agreement on government level. There are currently only discussions ongoing from European Commission with FCC and the White House. But this has not yet emerged in a cooperation agreement. And then we signed a multilateral MOU for the organization of a series of global 5G events, which was signed in October last year, and that we did in the presence of the EU Commissioner in Lisbon. And this next global event will take place in Rome in November this year. And that is an open event where we would also be happy to have participants from the US. There will be several speakers from the US. For example, there will be a speaker from FCC, from other institutions, and also industry companies. Yeah, all of this is, of course, happening in a global context. We have the activities in the international standardization in ITU and the research activities have to be matched, of course, with this external time schedule in order to contribute research results through international standardization. And that is basically indicated here, how we see that. There were already contributions from the former framework program to the ITU vision recommendation. We are now in 3GPP and the study item phase, where projects can contribute. This will quite soon move towards work items and then the development of the different releases of the standard. Then we have similar activities in the core network domain, mainly for IT elements in the core network. We have the preparatory process for the World Radio Communication Conference in ITU. And then also the preparation of trials. But when we go towards prototypes, product development, this is not in scope anymore of the PPP. Contributions to these activities are not done directly by the research projects. They are done by the usual channels via member organizations in these standards bodies or specification bodies. But there are established procedures how to contribute. And then there are also quite a lot of networking opportunities. What we did for this call too. There are websites available. There are possibilities to participate in the external working groups. We have developed, I will show this in the presentation on call two, on a recommendation how to prepare proposals. And then we were also running several information days. There will be the last one happening end of September. And then there's also a brokerage platform on the website. This is basically the first part to give you an idea what this 5G PPP is and how it's basically organized. It looks rather complex, but we have to imagine this organization has to handle in its lifetime several hundred million euro public funding plus private funding. There are currently about 160 or more than 160 organizations involved. We have 19 parallel projects. And that means it's a quite big machinery, which should also have impact. And therefore, we need a certain organization that this is working well. I think we take questions at the end. Is this the right understanding? Okay, I try to make this next a little bit brief because there is a lot of text because the call document from the European Commission is basically summarizing all the objectives and therefore I try to give you an idea. All of this is public information. You can read this then in detail.
Yes.
Again, the outline, I will focus on the objectives which are relevant for 5G PPP and then give you an idea what is in the call. On this slide are references where you find these documents. There is a work program. That's the overall work program. And here you find the specific work programs for the ICT domain. And US is in particular mentioned also in the 5G part. But in general, so Horizon 2020 is open for international cooperation. It's not only where US is specifically mentioned, it's in general open for international participation. The call two has a slightly higher budget, 154 million. But this means there are the two 5G PPP objectives, and there are also some specific joint calls between EU and Japan into you and Korea. These are rather small projects, small budget, but they are somehow counted under 5G PPP. The call dates are, the call was opened on May 10. It's closing in November, or November 8, which is of course quite soon. And again, we see the call is addressing wireless systems, radio network architecture, high capacity elastic optical networks, then again the software networks, more the IT part, ubiquitous 5G access, again based on optical technologies. And the optical technologies are very important for the backbone, front hole and back hole, and then also on network applications. This call is a little bit wider than call one. It's not simply a continuation. This diagram shows a mapping of the call objectives to the different or two different research areas. And the background of this diagram is we want to implement a program. And therefore, the different projects which will be selected later should be to a certain extent complementary to each other. That we avoid too big overlaps and that we also avoid gaps. That means that certain areas not addressed. And this diagram with research areas we have promoted to the community as a recommendation for proposal preparation. And now we go a little bit more into the work program, and this I will only touch slide by slide. We have a description of the challenge, what should be addressed in this objective, for example, ICT 7, which is on research and validation of critical technologies and systems for 5G. And there you see the keywords that should be addressed in project proposals. It's related to the phase two. And then it's describing certain elements which are addressed in the specific objectives which are coming on the following slides. Basically, this challenge is describing the overall environment for this objective. It's describing here a little bit the environment, also towards the core networks, the relation to standardization, the relation to spectrum in World Radio Communication Conference. Basically, we have to look at this overall environment. Then we see three strands, so-called strands. The first is on the wireless access and radio networks. The second on the optical networks. The third one on software networks. These are research and innovation actions. That means they have a somehow longer time horizon. When we go into detail, you see this is basically hierarchical structured. There are some more details mentioned for novel air interface technologies, which should be addressed. Then also hardware architectures, how this at the end will be really implemented. Then we have further bullets in this strand one on the functional architecture and then cooperation, cooperative operation of the heterogeneous access networks. That means there are already quite a lot of elements which are under this objective. And this is continuing here with further topics. That means this trend has a rather wide scope in the context of radio. Then this trend two is on the optical networks. It should also be more elastic, more flexible. We see here again a description of topics which can be addressed. Then this trend 3 is more looking at software networks, at the IT elements. And here you see SDN, NFV, the overall architecture, management of the connectivity, then solutions, how to allow the reallocation or any cost for the services, then scalability issues, efficiency issues. And also the last point is a plug and play vision for elements in the overall network. But all of this means it should be software based. It has to be flexible. Then also here the management of the networks. That basically means there is a lot of possibilities for topics. The funding for these projects is in the order of 5 to 8 million euro. That means these projects should not really exceed the 8 million, and they shouldn't be too small, and therefore there is here a recommended range. And on top of that is the public funding. The private investment, which makes, of course, these projects bigger. Then there is in the context, of course, an expected impact. This is summarized here. You see here basically the very high level challenges that I have shown in the very beginning, what we see towards 5G. And that means projects should contribute to meet these challenges. And this is then here a little bit more detailed, but the basic message is these should not be academic projects. They should really contribute to the overall development of standards. And finally, they should enable economic exploitation of results. And this is continuing here. You see there are quite high expectations also in the work program. Then there is a coordination and support action, which is facilitating the overall program. And this is also described here, again, with objectives. The funding is smaller. The funding is up to 3 million euro. And then there's also an expected impact. Basically, this coordination action should enable that the different projects can cooperate and that they can really contribute to the global development. We have a similar approach in this objective ICT8, which is on so-called convergent technologies. This objective 8 is on innovation actions. Innovation actions means these projects will have a shorter time horizon than research projects. And that means they are looking at ubiquitous access by leveraging optical technologies. That means they are building on basically existing technologies and so also on the flexible network applications. And then the structure is very similar. There are two strands, which are described here. What are basically the objectives in this trend? This is all taken from the work program. You directly find it there. Then this trend 2 is more on applications like NFV. It should be NFV here, I just see. The funding is again in the order of 5 to 8 million euro. And there is, of course, again, an expected impact. For example, how to contribute to the huge capacity increase, which is expected, or also to contribute to the reduction of energy consumption and so on. Then we have here some specific cooperation with Taiwan. Taiwan is offering demonstration facilities, and that was agreed between the European Commission and the Taiwanese government. That means that doesn't really apply for other regions. And for this specific action, there's again a small budget of only 2.5 million. Then, what is the expected impact here? This is also contribute to ITUR objectives. Again, the traffic increase, the low latency. But basically, you always see projects should contribute to real objectives, which will have an impact in the global economy later. And then with respect to international cooperation, the work program is saying the following. And this is true for both 5G PPP objectives. All these projects should be implemented as a program, not individual standalone projects. They should cooperate. Then here is some legal stuff on the cooperation, but what is important with respect to international cooperation, there is a specific focus on cooperation with these regions, China, Japan, Korea, Taiwan, and the US. The background for that is, these are countries and regions which have a specific impact in global standardization. And in order to develop common solutions or consensus, it's important to cooperate with these regions. And of course, US is one of them. And for the time being, there are US companies which have subsidiaries in Europe, or in Europe are participating. But it's also possible that organizations directly from the US can participate. And that means that the subsidiaries which are based in Europe, they are getting funding from the European Commission. If organizations from the US are participating, they have to look for other funding schemes in the US. But a participation in Horizon 2020 is directly open, also directly from the US. This is a summary, I think it's my last slide, a summary of call 2. The call was published on May 10 this year. It will be closed. It will be closed on November 8. Then we have in the objective 7, which is on research projects, 100 million funding. The support action has 3. In the innovation actions, there are 40 million funding. Then there are these specific projects with Taiwan. There are in total 5 million. That means 148. And then there in addition a little bit budget for the joint call with Korea and Japan. This is in total 6 million euro funding. And this will result in total in more than 20 projects, which we will see in phase 2. Yeah, this was basically the overview of call 2. And I think we are now going for discussion. And I hope I could give you some idea how this works in the European context.
Mm-hmm. Okay, hello everybody, sorry to interrupt. Now we will take the questions from the audience. We encourage you to write your question in the chat, because it will be more easy for us to moderate them, and only exceptionally we will allow somebody to raise his hand and talking by voice. And before doing it, I wanted to remind you that a feedback form will be sent you after the ending of this questionnaire. And I wanted to show you briefly a couple of slides regarding giving specific information on how to involve US stakeholders into Horizon 2020 proposal. So here you will have all the links and technical information on the procedure on how to submit the proposal. Also, these slides will be sent to you. So I come back to the original screen and open the floor for any questions you might have. Any? Okay. There is a question. Can we get involved in the expert teams of Picasso?
Yeah,
Eva, can you answer? Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. I can answer this. This is also some kind of question that we regularly receive through the website contact form. In fact, the expert groups with regard to 5G, but also to our other priority topics are already set up. So it is at the moment not possible to join the expert group in their core team. However, of course, all these expert groups have an action plan that involves interaction with other stakeholders from the topic areas, from the EU and from the US. And here you will be very welcome to get involved. So to give you an example, in the policy expert group, we have a number of policy briefs that are under preparation by the expert group members. But then we are very happy to collect feedback from experts outside the consortium and outside the expert group members to have information on their opinions, possible comments, etc. So the final version of the policy briefs are always taking into account those kind of suggestions and commenters that we could receive. Another example for could be to get involved in our public events of the expert groups, or of course the symposium that I've already mentioned before that will take place in June 2017 in Minneapolis. Also, we have a number of other items where you can of course be involved, maybe not directly in the expert groups, but still we have, for example, some questionnaires that we are sharing on our website. For example, we are currently preparing some report with regards to drivers, barriers, opportunities for collaboration in ICT between EU and the US. And there's a questionnaire that you could fill in and give us your opinion. You can find this under outreach on the site. If there's any specific question on that, I'll be happy to answer more specifically, but I hope this gives you a short information, at least on general terms.
Okay, are there any other questions from the audience which perhaps you would like to pose directly by voice to Dr. Moore? Otherwise, there are no questions, we would
please pose... if you have questions, raise them.
Mm-hmm. I think there are no questions from the audience.
Please, if you had any, please consider that you can contact still the address, contact Picasso, and we will come back to you. Otherwise, I would warmly thank Dr. Moore for this outstanding presentation.
Thank you very much.
And I remind you the email address to contact us is contact@picasso-project.eu. And please give us your feedback through the link that you see on the screen, compiling the feedback form. I think, I still don't see any questions. So I say bye to everybody and thank you for joining us. Again, thank you very much to Dr. Moore for this very interesting presentation.
Thank you also from my side on behalf of the coordination team for the organization of this webinar through the APRA team and Mr. Moore for the presentation given. I hope this has been useful to the audience, and as Margaret already said, if anyone has any question afterwards, don't hesitate to come back to us by email.
Yeah, and I remind you also that the recorded presentation, the recording and the single PPT presentations we will send to the participants of the webinar. Thank you very much. Goodbye. Goodbye, Dr.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.